I use this show to help me learn something new every single week, and I hope you do the same. Here's the thing. This week, I'm learning about something that I know nothing about. It's something that I've heard a lot about and that I want to know a lot about that can change the environment. Today, we learn more about composting. Thanks for listening and subscribing to Learning More. It's Russ with you. Again, I've got to give a shout out to those over there on Podbean. I've had a couple of conversations with people. It's so exciting. So if you're on Podbean, make sure you hit the little follow and all that stuff, or wherever you're listening, follow, subscribe, do whatever the little app says so that you can get this next week. Those of you that are subscribing, you probably heard a show that I did last season. We're talking financial advice, and I like to put a little spin on things, you know? So we talked financial advice, but I got to interview the CEO or CFO, sorry, of the Comedy Store in LA. And so we had this fun talk, and we also got to learn a little more about Pauly Shore and what he's really like. So if you haven't heard that one yet, I'll link to it in this episode. Go back, check that one out. But first, we've got a fun one here. And when you saw the description and you saw composting in the description, it's like, wait, really? Is this going to be a fun conversation? It's something that we all actually do need to learn about. And if we were all doing this, well, it might actually help climate change. So don't worry, though. We've got a little positive spin on this because I've got Cathy Nesbitt joining me. She has Cathy's Crawly Composters. I said it. That was a tongue twister. Thank you for joining me, Cathy.
Hi, Russ. I'm excited to be here.
So the twist here is, first of all, we get to talk about worms. But secondly, what's a laughter coach? What's this that I hear about you?
Yes. So my working title is Cathy Crawly Laughing Bean Queen. It's simple. It's simple solutions for today's challenges. Worms for indoor composting, sprouts for eating, grow your own, and laughter for overall health and wellness. So I am a laughter yoga teacher.
A laughter yoga teacher. You know what? I hate to make the whole podcast about that, but I feel like I could.
Absolutely.
I've heard of hot yoga, but I've never heard of laughing yoga. How does that work?
So laughter yoga, we need it more than ever, for sure.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah, it's not about fancy pants or poses. It's intentional laughter exercises designed to make us feel good. So we do. Started in 1995 by a medical doctor. And his goal is world peace. And there's laughter clubs in about maybe 120 countries now.
That's so cool. That is so cool. How do I get these people to listen to my podcast so that they just laugh at that? And then I feel better about the silly jokes that I make.
Right? Yeah. We know when we're laughing, we do feel good. We're secreting the love drug. So laughter yoga isn't about jokes or comedy. Lame jokes are fine.
You've heard my podcast. Okay.
but you know, like jokes are often, you know, they're cultural or they're sometimes about somebody. So not funny for that person, at least. So laughter yoga is just intentional laughter exercises. It's deep diaphragmatic breathing and then gentle movement. It's really a cardiovascular workout.
That is so cool. I love it. You know, I mean, you do feel so much better after having a laugh, you know, like I have this this Reddit channel. I love Reddit. And there's one of these channels that I follow. It's called Contagious Laughter, where it's just people laughing or something silly happens and then somebody starts laughing and you just can't help but start cracking up. So I'm assuming these classes, like one person starts laughing and everybody just starts going crazy. So I'm going to have to check one of those out. If I'm ever up in your area,
please do. I would love
I'm going to have to do that up there with you.
Oh, okay, it's online, Russ.
Oh, perfect. All right. Okay. What's the link?
it's Cathy's club. Yeah. It's every Tuesday. I have a free club every Tuesday. It's, maybe a little early San Francisco time, but it's 9:30 a.m. Eastern.
Oh my God! Okay, well, I'm gonna need to. you're gonna see me in there at some point. That seems like a lot of a great way to start my morning. Actually,
it's a beautiful day, and it is high energy because it's a morning session. Nice. My evening sessions are kind of getting people ready for sleep.
Right. That is so cool. I love that. So, okay, so that is not composting though, but I wanted to bring that up because it's kind of a cool little thing, and this is going to be a fun interview to chat about Composting. I almost said Comcast. A Comcast interview would not be fun. They usually mess stuff up. But composting, let's get into that. So if somebody is learning about this for the first time, like myself, I've heard of it. I've seen it be done at places. I've seen random, you know, things. I've heard people talk about it. I don't really know what it is. What is composting?
I love it. Thank you. So composting is nature's way to look after our organic matter. So our food scraps from the kitchen, our yard waste, coffee, tea, pasta, rice, all of our scraps from the kitchen. And composting is generally done outside. No special equipment is required. Maybe you have a composter or just a pile. You add in your, they say browns and greens. So the browns are the brown leaves, straw, paper, cardboard, any of those materials are your browns or your carbon. The nitrogen is your food scraps, coffee, tea, manures. So on the farm, you can also compost. If you had a dairy farm, your cattle manures or whatever. And what I'm talking about is an added extra bonus. It's okay. Indoor with worms. So,
okay.
You know,
you gave me cow manure and now you're giving me indoors. what is going on?
Indoors.
Okay. Okay. But how do you do this indoors? And I'm thinking the priority here is the smell. Because I feel like there would be some sort of odor from this.
Right. That's one of the myths about composting. No. So composting is aerobic process, meaning with oxygen. So if it smells bad, that means that the oxygen has been converted to methane, right? If it smells bad, it's not oxygen we're breathing. It's gas.
Okay.
So the beautiful part about indoor composting with worms is it does require oxygen. So if it ever smells bad, like rotting food, too much food is being put in, or it's too wet, something has happened to the conditions, and now it's become anaerobic, meaning without oxygen. So we can't breathe gas, neither can the worms. So it's a beautiful built-in feature.
Interesting. So how do you get rid of that? How do you convert it back? How do you add more oxygen?
I'm
asking dumb questions today.
No, you're not. No, this is beautiful. This is really beautiful. For people that don't know about composting, that have never done it, it does seem like, well, you're putting rotting food in. How could it not smell?
Right.
It's the little microbes. It's full of different organisms. Billions, in fact, of organisms are doing the work. And they're eating the odor. So they're eating the rotting food before it has a chance to convert to methane.
Oh, gotcha. Okay.
Right. So it is a process at the beginning when you're setting up your worm bin, any container will do. So we'll say a Rubbermaid tote or something similar to that. You need holes in your bin because it's aerobic. So you need to have airflow.
It needs to breathe.
It needs to breathe. Thank you. You need to have enough moisture so it's the consistency of a wrung out sponge. So about 75% humidity. And temperature. So the temperature is also one of the key ingredients. Indoor is perfect. So if we're comfortable, the worms are comfortable. Mm. I'm going to say 16 to 28 Celsius or about 60 to 80 Fahrenheit. I'm bilingual, Russ.
You are. Jeez. Wow. next, you'll teach me the metric system. That would be beautiful.
Well, I'm kind of messed up in both systems because they changed when I was in school. So it's like,
we keep hearing it's going to change someday. We're a little behind on that here in the States.
I don't know. You think the States is ever going to catch on to, or not catch on, but convert to the, you know, the whole world is almost metric.
I know.
And we've been metric for over 30 years now. So I don't know. I don't know that the States is ever going
to
change.
We like to be a little different, I guess.
Yeah, you do. So it does require a special worm. The worms that we use, there are thousands of types of worms. The worm that we use, the optimum composting worm, is a red wiggler worm. Isenia fetida is the Latin name. And they are surface-dwelling worms. They eat half their weight per day in food scraps. So I'll use easy math. I'll use a pound of worms. If you had a pound of worms, that you would be adding 3 to 4 pounds of food waste per week.
Wow. Okay.
Wow, it's substantial.
That's,
you know,
it's a lot.
it's a lot. You know, I just to go back to how I started my business. It's the 20th anniversary of my worm composting business. 20 years.
Wow.
What happened is 2002. I'm located just north of Toronto, largest city in Canada. In 2002, our landfill closed, and we started to export our garbage to the U.S. Although Canada is a pretty large country, second largest in the world, we couldn't find a new spot to site a landfill. We have remedied that, thankfully, in 20 years. We're not still exporting 1,000 trucks a week. Can you imagine?
Wow, that's crazy.
Can you imagine, like, the congestion on the highway? The greenhouse gas emissions from the from the trucks idling at the border, and then you know each state has a slogan. Michigan's slogan is Great Lakes State. Great Lakes means water. As this food waste breaks down, or as the garbage breaks down, the juice gets released, and then all those juices mix together. And they can't be contained. You know, they say, oh, the landfill liner is really good. You know, it's got a 10-year warranty. Oh, good. What happens after 10 years and it starts leaking?
Right.
It goes right into the water. That's right. Mm. Great Lake State.
Mm. Jeez.
Shame on us all.
Yeah.
This is a wonderful solution. I mean, no more shame. That was on the government. Right? It wasn't the people. I didn't decide to ship our garbage, and you didn't decide to receive our garbage.
Right.
So this is all on the government. And I had a solution. So I started my business thinking, oh, this is so great. I heard that a pound of worms and their descendants could transform a ton of organic waste in a year. And that the average Canadian, say, slash American family produces a ton of organic waste in the year. So I said, wow, every family needs a pound of worms. And I'm just the one to put a pound of worms in every house. Yeah, funny. Ha ha ha, so funny. And then I realized, like, I don't have business background. I do now. I'm 20 years in. But I started without, you know, a wing and a prayer. I was like, I had an idea. I had a solution for a big problem. And so I set about my business. And then I realized, oh, people don't want worms in the house. And right. We don't buy what we need. We buy what we want.
Right. So how do you get people to overcome that?
I would set up displays at trade shows and home fairs and whatever markets. Wherever I could have a table, I would have a table just educating people. And I quickly realized, okay, this isn't an impulse buy. Worms aren't, you know, even if it's a great idea, we don't always do what we think is a great idea. Sometimes we're just like, oh, that's a great idea. And we're just cheerleading the people that are doing the good work. So I started to do school workshops, and then I was like, now I just have to wait 20 years for them to have buying power. Yay, I made it.
You did.
You know, because then the kids go home, they tell the parents. And
right.
So I have got some business that way. But really, I think in the past 20 years, I was kind of creating the market. The market was here. People just didn't know. So I was raising awareness.
Right. So why wouldn't they? And again, I don't know anything about this. I'm going to ask not the best questions here, but I'm sure there's other people out there wondering this too. Like, okay, well, if these worms are so great, why don't they just put them on that trash, those thousands of trucks of trash, like put them on there and they get a huge snack? Like, why don't, is that a potential solution?
Yeah. So not really, because they are living creatures. Three key elements that I talked about. When you get all that fuel, which is the nitrogen, is the heat, then it really heats up. And composting itself without the worms is thermophilic, or heating up. It gets really super hot. So your worms would cook. So it's really challenging on a large scale to manage the temperature, I would say, and the contaminants, you know, again, they're living creatures. So if there was any harmful ingredients in the mix, you may kill your whole batch of worms.
Right. Right. And okay. So what are the worms doing? They're eating this, they're pooping it out. This is composting. Like,
Yes. The worms are the original alchemists. So they require the carbon and nitrogen. So the carbon, the paper, the nitrogen, the food scraps, they require both. And they take those two materials, which we call garbage, So they take that garbage and they convert it. Yes, their poo is black gold. It's nutrient-rich fertilizer that we can add back into the soil. So right now we're putting this, these scraps in the garbage. So they're not doing any good. They're just in a bag somewhere and then they end up in landfill and just, you know, rotting. Mm-hmm. Where this is converting it into something we can add back into the soil so we can grow more nutrient-rich food.
How do you make it so that other bugs aren't coming in there, you know, like the roaches or something like that coming into your home if you're storing this in there?
Yeah, so cockroaches aren't generally attracted to the worm bin because it's too moist. It's about 75% humidity. Okay. There are other organisms in there, absolutely. They're microscopic, so you generally don't see what's in there unless the conditions are right for that organism. The conditions change super fast in a worm bin. So change the temperature 1 degree, and now you've got different organisms. Increase the moisture by 1%, now you've got different organisms. And you may be able to see them. They may be visible. These are all decomposers. And it's the decomposers that break down the food. Those are the ones that are making it accessible for the worms. The worms are actually not doing the heavy lifting. They're the cleanup crew. So they're eating the poop of all these organisms. Gotcha. And then binding all that together. So each of the little castings, which is a fancy word for worm poo.
Okay. Casting. Got it.
A casting, yes. Is like a time release capsule, and the earth takes from it as it needs it. It's perfect plant food. So the worms and the plants and the soil have this symbiotic relationship. The worms are creating plant food that can be taken up directly by the roots. So the worms are creating this immune system in the soil. So there are always pathogens in the soil, but if the soil has enough good bacteria, enough beneficial bacteria, the pathogens don't stand a chance. They can't get to those roots and start doing damage.
Gotcha. Now, how do you get people past, you know, sitting on the couch and wondering if a worm's going to come crawling up behind them as they're watching TV?
Yeah, it's funny. They do stay in the box. Now, the only reason they would get out is if the conditions aren't right in the bin. So breathe through their skin if it's too acidic or too wet or not enough food. If something's not right, they will crawl out, but they don't have eyes, Russ. And they're eating half their weight, so there's no point going sightseeing. They can't see. Okay. Right? So if
they're crawling out. Okay, that makes me feel a little better.
If they're crawling out, there's a problem in.
Gotcha.
Yeah. And, you know, when you asked about can't you just throw the worms on the pile of scraps? I thought your question was going to be, if this is so great, why isn't everyone doing it? Mm. And the challenge with this is that the worms, I have a psychology degree and I'm learning now that people may have been traumatized as children in the schoolyard or by a sibling after a rain. Someone chased them around with a worm and they were traumatized. Gotcha. So if you were traumatized as a child,
do you really want to have that in your house? Right.
Right. You're not looking to that as a solution. Mm. So, you know, I chose media as my marketing strategy, and I've had over 300 articles, TV, radio, I have a documentary. If you're afraid of worms, you're not even looking at those. You're not reading that article. You're not listening to that interview.
Right. Right. Well,
but you're
listening
to this one.
you're calling it, you know, Cathy's crawly composters. I've said it right the first time, second time, a little more rough, but just insert the word creepy crawly, like, right? Like, we've heard that since we were kids too. So it's sort of like it's embedded there as these are kind of creepy, right? And you think of snakes, like snakes are kind of creepy crawly as well. So like bring them into the home. There is a little bit of a obstruction there, I guess, that's got
it's a psychological barrier, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And even the word worm, like can of worms, is a bad expression, like, oh, you've opened a can of worms.
Right.
I'm trying to change that. I'm working on that.
Right. Yeah, can of worms, you've turned into a box of worms. Okay.
You know, and parasites, and there's computer viruses that are worms. So worms seems to have a bad connotation. So sometimes we hear these words and we have an association already.
Well, I think that's where the sense of humor helps as well. And doing all these workshops. So you do workshops with kids.
Absolutely. That's my favorite thing. You know, during COVID, before COVID, I was doing between 100 and 200 events a year. Workshops, speaking, going into corporations. I mean, just wherever I could be, I was. And so it kind of gave me a big pause, but it was like, oh, now what do I do? And I realized during that time that the laughter actually came to me in 2012. And one more person said to me, ew, worms in the house. And I'd heard it many times in the 10 previous years I had, but I didn't right. hear it. I didn't listen. 2012, I heard it. It hit my heart. And I was like, oh, how am I going to do this? This is so hard. Why do I care so much? And then I was introduced to laughter yoga, and laughter yoga has been a big part of my health plan for 10 years now. I laugh every day, full on, belly laugh, 10 to 15 minutes of sustained belly laughter is kind of what the gauge of what you're looking for. Right. You know, where your stomach's hurting, your cheeks are hurting, those are the laughter muscles.
That's beautiful. And you know, I mean, that's one of the reasons why I like doing like the whole podcasting thing is because generally when I'm doing this, first of all, both people are in a good mood. I'm in a good mood. You're in a good mood. Like, and then there's just some sort of laughter and some sort of fun, you know, doing the podcast. It does make you feel great.
And it's always great when you're learning more.
Exactly. See, there you go. There you go. Cheap plug for the show. I love it. So, okay. We've got the worms in our house. We've got a smell starting to develop, right? Like, let's say that starts to happen. I'm jumping back to that because that is one of my big concerns, right? How, like, thinking about this, I feel like I've got to be a scientist in order to get this done. Like, how do I know how to balance everything so that the worms are happy and my nose is happy?
Ah, yes. Great. Your nose is the guide. If it's starting to smell, it's starting to become anaerobic without oxygen. So all you do, I have a worm hotline. So you would call my hotline. And I would help you. I would talk you down off the ceiling. So it's just because if it's smelling, something's happened. It's either too wet, too much food. Something's happened where there's not enough airflow. So what you need to do if there's too much food, remove some of the rotting food, gently fluff it up to add more airflow in there. Perhaps if you've made your own bin, there may not be enough holes in the bin. So just punch some more holes in your container. And there are systems as well. If people didn't want, you know, at a certain point, you do need to harvest the worms or separate the worms from the compost. If you're using a single unit, the easiest way is the dump and sort. So you dump your bin on a plastic sheet, put it in small round piles. The worms are photosensitive or afraid of the light, so they go down into the piles. It takes maybe an hour to separate the worms from the compost. Once you get your worms separated, you set up your new bedding, add the worms back in, and use the black gold on your plants.
Okay.
There are systems which takes away the need to harvest, and it helps manage the moisture.
I was just going to ask that. Yeah. Is there a way to make that, to simplify that? So let's hear about that a little bit.
Yeah, absolutely. There are many systems on the market. I have a beautiful one made in Canada. It's like a stool. It looks like a stool. So it's a functional piece of furniture that you can sit on. And it comes with two trays. So it's fairly small. It's got a small footprint for people that live in small condos. Like think of New York, right in New York City, some of those apartments are pretty small. Mm-hmm. So they are still able to do this, which we feel good. You know, when we're doing good work, we feel good. And when we're contributing to, you know, potentially mitigating climate change or, you know, even converting some of our scraps. So then we're growing a garden. Like these are all feel good things. So the systems, the one that I have has holes in the bottom of each tray. So when the first tray fills up, you add the second tray on top and the worms migrate up through the holes. So they just follow the food and they leave behind their black gold. So for people that are afraid of worms and this sounds like a great idea, but I don't want to do it. Getting a system is the way, because right. then you just set it up the first time add your worms in, and then you can kind of just feed them and forget them.
Gotcha. Now, and how long do the worms last? Like, are you having to refresh worms? Like, how does that work?
Yeah, sadly, no. That's the challenge with my business model. There's no built-in obsolescence. And they breed more than rabbits, but they're not cute and cuddly, depending who you ask, I guess. Right. So the worms, under ideal conditions, they will double in number every 3 to 5 months. And so don't freak out, people that are listening. The worms will regulate their population based on available space and available food. You would never be overrun with worms. The adults start dying off. If you don't do anything, if you don't remove some and set up another bin or whatever, the worms will start dying off to make room for the babies. And it's just a wonderful system. They've got it worked out.
Wow. That's pretty cool. So you're not only like doing this whole thing, but you're also breeding the worms essentially within this so that they're self-replacing, so that once you set this up, I mean, it's not a set it and forget it, unfortunately. It's like, it's, you're going to have to do things, you know, like you mentioned.
You got to feed them for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. But I mean, it seems like it's a little bit easier than I thought it was going to be. And okay. So you're talking about doing this inside. What about doing this outside? You said that they were sort of sensitive to temperature. And you know, fortunately I'm in the San Francisco Bay Area, so the temperature doesn't range too much. But it does get cold at night. So is there anything that you need to do differently within like the winter months versus the summer months, or, you know, evening like versus day? Like, is there anything that you have to do to be sensitive to take care of the worms themselves?
Love it. Thank you. That's beautiful. So San Francisco probably is a fine, you could probably do it outside year round in San Francisco. Canada, not so much. And Texas, probably not so much, right? Too hot in, mm-hmm. in some places, too cold in other places. And you're right. It's the temperature change. So maybe it's a lovely temperature during the day, 75 or whatever. And then at night it goes down to 62. That, you know, it's the fluctuation that the worms don't like. So ideally, if you can do it inside year round, that would be optimum. If that's not an option, maybe in a garage, if you have a, you know, a space or a shed,
okay.
You wouldn't want to put them in the sun. Or if you have holes in the top, you wouldn't want them outside where they may get rained upon. And then Right. Now your bin's too wet.
Well, I would think birds too might come down. And I mean, I know they're down
there's a
inside,
lid on it. There's
but
a lid.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah. Raccoons. Now, raccoons, again, if it's outside, They would be one of the predators that they love worms. And right. they have them, their little hands there that they can get into things. They're right. So smart, but they're a nuisance.
Yeah, they are.
Yeah. You know, and same with places where there's, you know, mountain lions or bears, cottage country, where you wouldn't want to be composting outside for fear of attracting those critters. So again, you can do this inside. You're not going to attract rodents inside, but if you compost outside, sometimes you create a nice environment for rats and mice and those kind of little things that people don't want to attract.
Again, like, you know, there's the whole prevention of that and just making sure that everything is, because you also don't, you know, you don't want to turn your backyard into, you know, wild kingdom with the mice and the raccoons and all that stuff.
No,
so
absolutely.
I think that's probably another obstacle that people are encountering with this. And you've got some advice on your website for all of this as well, like setting up the box, how to do all of this. So Cathy'sComposters.com is the website. Now, before we go, I have one other question for you is, what's the biggest mistake that people make when they're doing this and they're trying to do this on their own?
Being too enthusiastic about feeding. You know, when you hear, oh, they eat half their weight and, but patience is required, right? They don't have teeth, so they're dependent on all the little microorganisms that we can't see. So when you first start your worm bin, patience is required to allow the microorganisms to increase in number. And as they increase, then the worms are able to eat more material. So I would say the biggest error that people make is they're too enthusiastic about feeding the worms. Or on the other side, maybe they love the worms so much, so they give all the good scraps. I did a talk once and one of my customers was in the audience. So I said, the more rotten the food, the better it is for the worms. It's like a worm buffet. Like the more we go, gross. there like, yay, this is perfect. And she started laughing. She said, oh my gosh, I feel like I've been mistreating my worms. She said, when I...
she said, worm abuse.
Oh, but as I was as I was preparing my vegetables, she would be like, oh, that's a beautiful scrap. I'm going to put that. And she would put all the nice looking scraps aside for the worms.
She's being very selective for the worms. That's great.
Well, that's this one's awesome. Too rotten.
Right. That's funny. That's funny. So the other, you know, the other thing that we mentioned earlier is, you know, this does help against climate change, you know, like, so this is something that we can do. I mean, people are always wondering like, oh, what can I do? You know, I'll drive less. I'll do this. I'll do that. Like, this seems like something easy that they can do. You know,
we all eat, Russ. We all eat. We all produce food scraps.
Exactly. Exactly. So I've got a whole new thing for you, Cathy. I came up with this during the interview, and I think what you can call this whole thing is what you're doing is you're not global warming. You're global worming is what you're doing.
Global warming. Yep.
Global warming. I'm gonna let you trademark that one if you want.
That's awesome. I love it.
Hey, you know, one other thing that one other trend that came up. You mentioned the pandemic earlier, and one thing that a lot of people started doing was having like the backyard chickens. Right now, I've got three backyard chickens, and they produce a lot of food, we'll say, for these worms, a lot of poop. And Is that something that's also compostable and something that we could do? I mean, because of course that's a little stinky. I don't know if you have backyard chickens, but they can be a little smelly, especially, you know, they're leftovers, we'll say.
So I would say be careful with that chicken manure or poultry manure because it's very high in ammonia.
Gotcha.
You do need to add eggshells into the system. The worms require the calcium for reproduction, and the eggshells help to balance the pH in the bedding. So if your material is too acidic, the eggshells will help to mitigate that as well.
Gotcha. Okay. See, I called the worm hotline. So if people are having issues with it, they want to get started, how do they get a hold of you and what do they do next?
Yeah. So cathyscomposters.com is my website. Tons of information there. On Twitter, I'm at Squirm.
I love that.
Clever, right? That's the name of a group of worms, by the way.
Gotcha.
Squirm of worms.
Squirm of worms. And then should we plug the phone number as well, just in case somebody wants to call the worm hotline?
Absolutely. It's the 800 line. It works from the States as well. It's 888-775-9495.
Awesome. Cathy, thank you so much for joining me and helping me learn more about composting.
Russ, I love this. Thank you for your great questions.
Thank you. And thank you for listening, subscribing to Learning More. Oh, and reviewing Learning More. That always helps as well. We encourage you and thank you for rating this podcast and sharing it with your friends. Those over on Podbean, chat with me. Like, there's plenty of opportunity to do so. I'm trying to get back to everybody, but reach out, leave some comments on the episodes and I'll get back to you. I've actually had some great book suggestions from various folks helping me out there on Podbean, and I'll make some future episodes out of those as well. I invite you to check out my business podcast as well. It features actually business owners, kind of like Cathy here, that have started out on their business and they're getting things rolling and they've had some success. Cathy, I'm going to have to consider you bringing you over to DIY for Business, our other podcast as well. That's available at DIYForBusinessPodcast.com. We've got plenty of new episodes coming out for Learning More. Of course, we're going to take a little break for the holidays. That's coming up soon here, but don't worry, we got plenty of more episodes. So make sure you hit subscribe so you don't miss any of those episodes. If you've got something that you would like to learn more about, you can also head over to the website, learningmorepodcast.com, and leave your suggestions there. I might make an entire episode about it. Again, thank you for listening. Thank you for subscribing. And thank you for reviewing Learning More. I'm Russ, and I look forward to learning more with you next time.